Oh, my friends.
Friends? I thought he said we were the enemy.
Yeah, that's what I heard. Ed?
No, let me explain. No, you don't understand. No, I didn't mean... No, I think my hands are bad. Oh, no.
Simba has confronted his dragon, and in doing so, is rewarded. Welcome to the last lecture in the series, entitled Slaying the Dragon. For this lecture, we're going to go over four specific topics. One, metaphor and how stories are formed. Two, where the dragon exists. Three, the strength of the dragon. And four, how to slay your dragon. Now, if you cannot tell, I'm speaking very heavily, metaphorically. And as we learned, metaphor is used as a literary technique in order to provide you with knowledge of things you don't know by using things you do know.
My mom always said, life was like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get.
Now, metaphor can be very powerful, but in the story that we are reviewing, the metaphor is used to explain something that you are going to universally have to deal with, i.e., the dragon. And when I say universally, I mean a truth that exists above truths. Let me explain. There are things that are true for a particular culture. It's true, like our dollar bill, for example. That is true as far as American currency goes. But there's a universal truth of money, i.e. gold and precious metals. They go beyond mere culture. The point is that in these much deeper stories, we are talking about universal truth. Truth that every single one of you is going to have to deal with one way or another, and probably have dealt with already. A truth above all truths. How does this relate to philosophy? Well, as philosophers, literally philo, desirer or seeker of Sophi, truth. We are now philosophers and have been so for the past 10 lectures.
And his great-grandpa was Thomas Griffin, a great philosopher.
Thomas, would you please go look for a job?
Why?
So with that understanding of truth, now let's head into stories. In particular, how stories are formed. We'll start the very foundation of human experience. We as humans acted before we started reflecting on the actions. This makes perfect sense, right? Think about a child. A child just habitually acts and does things. They are not reflecting on the motivations on why they're doing things. So we act first, and then we reflect. So now, let's take that a bit farther. So, now we're observing, okay? And as we observe, we start noticing patterns emerge.
Boy, look at George. He's giving it the T-bone. He's jumping up and down like some kind of monkey.
That's to say that as we're doing things and watching other people, or more importantly, watching other people do things, we start to distill like patterns. That is to say, when we see the same thing happening over and over again, that gets logged in as more important than something they only see once. That's what we mean by patterns, okay? So now they're reflecting, and now they're noticing patterns are occurring, okay? Like, for example, when two kids play, and they play mom and dad or something like that, they are distilling all of the actions of mom and dad into what they think represents dad and what they think represents mom. Now, the patterns that start emerging start to define the character. That's what I mean by when two children play mom and dad. All right? They found the pattern. They distilled the pattern into something that they see all moms and dads perform. And now that becomes like the definition of mom and the definition of dad. It ends up defining them. So, moving away from the pattern of mom and dad, okay, because as you can see, we probably have some pretty solid definitions of what you believe is essentially an act that a mom would perform, i.e. maybe taking care of their kids. And then a chief distilled pattern for what we define as dad, somebody who takes care of them and protects them, all right? Now, understanding that, there are many patterns that occur, but one chief pattern is the hero myth, the hero journey. And the hero's journey is the pattern where somebody willingly goes into the dangerous but advantageous world and conquers the territory, i.e. they go into the world, they take out the dragon, and they're rewarded with gold. And that's what we're going to focus on in this lecture. The chief pattern that became the story for all heroic journeys. So now we can move on to discuss where the dragon exists. So where do dragons exist? And again, there are many forms of dragons, but I'm going to try to distill this in a pattern and a story, especially with the story that we're viewing. Think about the knights and the Holy Grail. Before the knights were able to figure out their journey, and again, I've discussed this before, but it's worth reviewing. Before the knights could figure out where to start their journey, they were told to look at the dark forest that bordered their kingdom, and they are to enter the forest that looks darkest to each knight. That's where they start their quest. That's where the dragon exists. The dragon exists in the darkest corners. Why do they exist in this darkest point? Well, that's either where you kept them, or that's where they exist and where they hold the most valuable riches. You haven't gone there yet. So let's focus on the first one, where you place them. And for that, the dragon metaphorically represents your fears. The fear is the place you do not want to go, so you put it away. Think about Simba when he was with his gang. As Simba is talking to Timon and Pumbaa, you can see that he fears them finding out about his past. What happened to his father was placed away in the back of his psyche and thus became his dragon in that form. He hid away what happened and he tried to live a life avoiding it. What happens when you avoid it? It doesn't get weaker. It gets much stronger. The one example I like to give is the tax bill. You get a tax bill for $50. You choose not to spend money on it immediately. What happens in 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, in 1 year? That thing is much more powerful than it was before. You may need to go through many people to track it down and pay for it. And in paying for it, it's probably much more expensive than it was before. And if you wait too long, you've got the tax man coming for you at your house or garnishing your wages. It doesn't go away. It gains in strength. And that's what happens here. When people put their fears away because they don't want to confront them, it gains in strength. It starts taking over other areas of their life. It's how it becomes phobias. It's why people need to go through years and years of therapy in order to conquer these fears, because they've kept them away for so long. Now we'll get into another metaphoric understanding of the dragon and what it may represent. It can represent the unresolved past. When Simba ran away, he put the tragedy in the back of his mind, unresolved. He ran away from his responsibilities. And what happened? The responsibilities didn't just sit there. No, not at all. The kingdom withered away. He ran away and the kingdom destroyed itself. The dragon also metaphorically means the things of which you ignore. We've gone over this quite a bit. The new sound of the engine, the new creak in your house, the wobbling of the frying pan. All of these things, which you are given warning signs for, by the way, that you ignore. The dragon becomes stronger and stronger, waiting for opportunity to strike. And in this example, we come to Mufasa and Scar. Mufasa ignored the chaos in his own kingdom. Scar was plotting against them and Mufasa didn't see it. He ignored the malevolence in his own kingdom, and eventually it struck out against him. You can imagine if Batman ignored the Joker. The Joker's not just going to go away. He is chaos incarnate. That is to say, Joker represents the epitome of chaos. He's not going away. All he's doing is waiting for opportunity, just like Scar. Scar waited for his opportunity and plotted, and eventually, Mufasa was killed. So in this case, this is another representation of the dragon and where the dragon exists. The dragon exists in the places that you are ignoring, and it's gaining strength and waiting for a time to strike. Now, one final metaphoric representation of the dragon, one specifically that relates to the hero myth that we all must one day shoulder and conquer: the unconquered territory. This is the dragon that exists out of the borders of your conquered territory. Metaphorically, it represents what you need in order to succeed. There is a world out there that is full of riches, waiting for you to come and claim them. Whether you want to be a firefighter, whether you want to be a lawyer, whether you want to be a detective, this is the dragon of the unconquered territory that eventually you need to go into and battle in order for you to find your place in the world. There's the other metaphoric dragon, and it's represented in Simba having to go back to his kingdom. That is not the same kingdom anymore. It is completely different. It is definitely unconquered territory, where his dragon exists. It's his responsibility, and for you, it's the dragon that awaits you in the real world. And the gold is your reward for slaying the dragon. In each case, the gold is freedom from the chains of the past. It's the annihilation of the fears that plague you. It is the empowerment and striking down the things in the present that seek to destroy you. And it is the success in going out into the world and earning your place. Those are four metaphoric representations of the dragon and their representative rewards. This is why it's so difficult to attain.
Dottie, you want to go back home to Oregon and make 100 babies? Great, I'm in no position to tell anyone how to live. But sneaking out like this, quitting, you'll regret it for the rest of your life. Baseball is what gets inside you. It's what lights you up. You can't deny that.
It just got too hard.
It's supposed to be hard. If it wasn't hard, everyone would do it. The hard is what makes it great.
It's what makes the rewards great. Its difficulty is what makes it great. Now we'll move on to the strength of the dragon, how it's fed. So, this starts in our very nature of being creatures of habit. Good or bad, when we do something repeatedly, it becomes second nature. We do the same thing over and over again. Through repetition, it becomes habitual. Continue even further, and it becomes who you are. That is why we literally become creatures, our being, created by the rituals we perform every single day. So knowing that we're creatures of habits, now you get into how the dragon metaphorically gets its strength. Well, in the aspect of fear, it gains in strength as you habitually avoid it.
Puny human.
Because now it's a part of you. And avoiding it is the very habit that keeps feeding it. The longer you take, the more it's fed. The fear does not go away. It gets stronger. So in this sense, it is metaphorically fed by you ignoring it. It feeds on your fear itself. Your inability to stop doing things that are bad for you, or the inability to let go of things that are bad for you, metaphorically feeds the dragon. Often somebody is miserable simply because they can't let go of the things that are bad for them. In the sense of Mufasa and Scar, the dragon grows stronger the more you ignore it. That should be clear by now. So our fears, our reservations, the things that we hide from, all become the metaphoric dragon. And the gold itself, the riches that await you, represent the freedom of slaying that dragon. Now one final piece. The metaphoric dragon that awaits you in the unconquered world. The strength of the dragon is actually congruent to how lofty is your goal and your desire. That is to say, if you have a simple goal, then the reward is very small because the dragon is very small. But if you have a grand and lofty goal, then man, that dragon is much bigger, but so is the reward. So then it comes down to how much of a fight are you willing to put forth?
And so the guru said, if you want to be on the same level I'm on, I'll meet you tomorrow at the beach at 4 a.m. He liked the beach. I said, I want to make money. I don't want to swim. Guru said, if you want to make money, I'll meet you tomorrow, 4 a.m. So the young man got there at 4 a.m. He all ready to rock and roll, got on the suit. He should have wore shorts. The old man grabs his hand, said, how bad do you want to be successful? He said, real bad. He said, walk on out in the water. So he walks out into the water. Watch this. When he walks out into the water, it goes waist deep. So he like, this guy crazy. Adrian, he's like, I want to make money. He got me out here swimming. I didn't ask to be a lifeguard. I want to make money. He got me in. So he said, come out a little further. Walked out a little further. Then he had it right around this area. the shoulder area. So this old man crazy. He making money, but he crazy. He said, come on out a little further. Came out a little further. It was right at his mouth. My man like, I'm about to go back in here. This God is mine. So the old man said, I thought you said you wanted to be successful. He said, I do. He said, walk a little further. He came, dropped his head in, held him down, hold him down. My man getting scratching, holding him down. I got you. I know you brushed it out, but I got you. He had him held down. I need you for an illustration. He had him held down just before my man was about to pass out. He raised him up. He said, I got a question for you. Somebody answer the question for me. He said, when you were underwater, what did you want to do? Lit. I'm looking for a different word though than lit. What's that word? He said, I wanted to breathe. He told the guy, he said, when you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful. I don't know how many of y'all got asthma in here today, but if you ever had an asthma attack before, you short of breath, SOB, shortness of breath, you wheezing. The only thing you trying to do is get some air. You don't care about no basketball game. You don't care what's on TV. You don't care about nobody calling you. You don't care about a party. The only thing you care about when you're trying to breathe is to get some fresh air. That's it. And when you get to the point where all you want to do is be successful as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful. And I'm here to tell you, number one, that most of you say you want to be successful, but you don't want it bad. You just kind of want it. You don't want it badder than you want a party. You don't want it as much as you want to be cool. Most of you don't want success as much as you want to sleep. Some of you love sleep more than you love success. And I'm here to tell you today, if you're going to be successful, you've got to be willing to give up sleep.
And with that, we come to slaying the dragon. Well, in the aspect of fear, you have to slay the dragon by recognizing first. It needs to be on your radar.
You're the Sith Lord.
You need to identify it as a target, whether it be the unresolved past, whether it be a fear, whether it be a goal that you want in the world. The first step is to recognize it as a dragon, because you are not going to hit anything unless you have a target. You have to have something to aim towards in order to fire and hit the target. Now, the second part comes with human beings' unique ability to understand vulnerability. That is to say, we understand how to hurt one another because I know how to hurt myself. The knowledge that I possess on what hurts me gives me knowledge of what hurts others. So you need to understand the weaknesses of your particular dragon. And for that, you need knowledge. Knowledge produces the several targets that represent the weaknesses of the metaphoric dragon. Say, for example, your dragon is to get to Oxford University as a lawyer. Well, you've identified the dragon of chaos that holds the rewards, i.e., getting into Oxford. Now you need to identify the dragon's weaknesses. In order to do that, you need knowledge. So here we go. Here are our many targets, each representing the weakness of this particular dragon. So as you see here, you're going to need an entrance requirement. You're going to need an admission test. You're going to need subject requirements. And you're going to need to understand the duration of time it'll take to slay this particular dragon. So we can start simply with the entrance requirements. Well, what is AAA? What are AAA levels? Well, A levels, short for advanced levels, are school leaving qualifications that are taken by students in the UK. Students usually choose 3 or 4 subjects and take 2 years to study for these A levels between the ages of 16 and 18, and they need to pass with 3 A's. We have identified 3 specific targets or weaknesses in the dragon on the journey to take it down. Now we move on to the test itself. The test itself is a LNAT, the National Admissions Test for Law. So in order to apply for law and law studies, you need to take this test. And what is this test? Well, it's a 2-hour and 50-minute test divided into two sections. And then you get to understand it's a computer-based test with multiple choice questions, and there are 42 of them. Now you have identified even more weaknesses in your particular dragon, and you know it's going to take 3 to 4 years of constant study and good grades to take down this dragon. You have identified the weaknesses, and now you have targets of which to aim. That's how the dragon metaphorically represents the things that you are going to need to do in the world in order to be rewarded. What's the reward? Well, in this case, it's a reward of a law degree from the most prestigious college in the world, Oxford University. You have identified all the targets, and now you make a systematic attack on every single weakness, and the dragon falls. The hoard of gold is yours.
Good endure.
So now what happens? Well, what happened to Simba? Simba walks up and he roars. He bares his fangs. How did he gain those fangs? When you slay that dragon, you are now somebody who is formidable to the world. You straighten your back and you show the most vulnerable area to the world. Because guess what? You conquered your dragon. Your back stiffens and you show the world you're formidable by finally earning the only respect that really matters in this world, self-respect. You have become a somebody. It's not virtuous to be weak and ineffective like a bunny. No, it's virtuous to be a knight who carries a sword but knows when to use it. It's not the knight that does not have a sword that is virtuous. You have gone into the world, you have earned your teeth, and you now bear your fangs when you need to. The fight hardens you. The fight makes you formidable. The fight earned you the treasure. So in the metaphoric sense of the dragon that represents fear, or the dragon that represents the things of which you have ignored, the reward itself is the unburdening of these fears. It's finally letting go of the things that have plagued you. And therefore, this is why it is always the dragon that hoards the gold. So, for this week's assignment, it is not graded. It is purely optional. It will be an extra credit assignment that can be used towards something you didn't turn in or a perfect score on two other things in Google Classroom. And it's simply this. I want you to write 3 paragraphs telling me a story of when you metaphorically took on a dragon. This needs to be nonfiction, i.e., this needs to be a true story. What metaphoric dragon did you slay? And with that, we've reached the end of the Lion King lectures. Have a nice day.